Okay, so,
Do you need a pointer?
If you have one, that'd be great, otherwise it's okay, I'll just use the, I can.
Anybody have a pointer on?
I can't point.
I can bring my bag today. Okay, so it's really my great, great pleasure to introduce Claude Alain. He did his PhD in the University of Quebec in Montreal, and then did his postdoc in Martinez. It's the VA hospital in Martinez, where they have a unit affiliated, I think, with Davis, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Davis, with Woods. We almost crossed our roads, but he finished his postdoc a few years before I started mine in the same region, but we crossed roads a few times. After doing his postdoc, he went back to University of Toronto, where he is a professor at the Department of Psychology ever since, as well as in the Rockman Institute at the Baycrest Hospital, which is a great center for neuropsychology and for cognitive neuroscience. I urge everybody to look at what they're doing there. And Claude has done terrific work. I mean, it's impossible to follow all the papers that come out of your lab, but I've went through it, went across his work. We did a lot of work about streaming, auditory scene analysis and streaming, and auditory processing and attention, which we'll talk about today, but he also does work, which unfortunately we'll have to hear sometime else, about music and cognitive decline, its effect on cognitive decline, right? And on some others, and I thought of bringing some cocktails to the cocktail
yes.
party, but then thought that it's not that cocktail party, it's a different.
Yeah, and I shouldn't put the cocktail party, I raise up the expectation that cocktail party.
Okay, so thank you.
You're welcome. This is great. It's my first visit to Israel. It's great to be here. It's great to visit different places. I have a chance to visit some friends in Tel Aviv and Beersheba, and I'll be visiting also Haifa. And I'm going to present some of the, this is, what I'll do is present you some new work, some new direction of research that we've been taking for the past 6-7 years. So it's pretty much work in progress. So it's not as, thought of as other things. So if you have any suggestion, ideas, they're more than welcome. If you have questions, you can stop me anytime. There's no need to go through the whole presentation in itself. If you have, it could be interesting to have more a conversation rather than a lecture. So to start with, I just thought maybe just telling you where I'm coming from, where I am. My background, I see myself as an experimental psychologist. So I've been trained in psychology, and my interests are mainly in to understand the neural basis of how do we perceive, how do we attend, and how do we remember auditory event or auditory object. When I start primarily in the context of what we call auditory scene analysis. This is the idea of how do we perceptually organize acoustic information into meaningful auditory representation or auditory object. How do we manage to separate sounds that occur at the same time? So what are the cues that can help us to do that? And from a neuroscience perspective, so what are the brain mechanisms or correlates that underlie our ability to separate sounds that occur at the same time or sounds that occur over time? How do we build these types of representation? Now, you can imagine that if you think about scene analysis and sounds that occur at the same time, we're not far off from speech perception, especially speech perception in the context of the cocktail party. How do we track a particular talker against other talkers occurring at the same time? What are the cues that we use? What is the impact of age? What is the impact of hearing loss? And this is the kind of research we've been doing my group to try to better understand and characterize. Now that we identify these, not only we try to identify the deficit in itself, but we're also looking in a way to mitigate them using different techniques, either auditory training, so we've been working on developing a speech and noise training program. We also, this is the context where we're applying, or look at the impact of music engagement or music activity in a way to mitigate speech perception deficit in older adults, especially in noisy situations. This is perhaps one of the most common complaints of older adults starting, I shouldn't say older adults, I should say even middle-aged adults, starting by the age 50, 55, going to restaurants or dinner party can start to be a little bit cumbersome. It's hard to understand what people are saying and so on. And this is one of the reasons why, in fact, a lot of us may consult for an audiologist who will seek audiology services. The other thing that we do in my group is also some work looking at the neuroscience of music perception, mainly in the context of cross-sectional study, comparing musician on musician, musician with perfect pitch. And again, this is tied up a little bit with the speech perception work that we do, looking at how music training may help mitigate some of the change that occur in cognition as you get older. And finally, the kind of a more recent direction that we've been taking, this is tied, in fact, to scene analysis, and I think that will come a little bit obvious when I start. I've become intrigued or more interested to look at the interplay between attention and memory. Often in psychology, these two concepts have been kind of studied separately, although we do know that we can attend to representation in short-term memory. We can think back about what we have in the visual, for example, visual scene that we saw a moment ago, or we can think back about the sound that we just heard a moment ago. We also know that a long-term representation can have an impact on how do we deploy attention. If we hear our name, for example, that may capture our attention. This is often used to describe the cocktail party. We were talking about that at lunch. So familiarity with sound may help us guide or influence how we're going to direct attention and so on. So this is the type of thing I've become interested in. What is the neural underpinning? But the reason my interest in there is tied up to the problem of how does it apply in a situation when you have sounds that occur at the same time. Often we think about attention and memory in a sequential term where things occur over time, but most of my work today has to do with situation where we have mixture of sounds rather than a sequence of events. And I thought maybe I'll start to illustrate a little bit of the problem that we are facing in many auditory situations. I don't know how many of you are familiar with auditory scene analysis, so I thought I'll start with something more general. So this is an example where you can have, for example, sound from a car, people talking, dog barking. Essentially what happened is that this acoustic energy coming from this different source will sum up into one acoustic wave. And that acoustic wave was going to hit the eardrum. And from that pair pressure, now the job of the auditory system is to decompose that air pressure and retrieve essentially those three different sound sources that we have out there. Now, this is not a trivial problem, and just as an exercise, I'd like to try to imagine a situation that you're standing by your lake and you got these two channels right here, which is essentially your ear canal, and that would be the ear drum. And by looking at how the water, the wave of hitting these little pieces of paper, you have to decide how many boats there is on the lake, how big are the boats, how fast are going in the boat. And that's the kind of situation that the auditory system is trying to resolve. Now, this is just to give you a little bit of an idea of the complexity. Now, what we learn over the years, that many cues can be helpful in the way we parse or organize acoustic information. We learned that, for example, that sounds that are similar in frequency can be perceptually grouped together, and that would help separate sounds that occur at the same time. We've learned that sounds that are different in terms of their location can also be locations who can be used to separate sounds that occur at the same time and so on. Okay. So in the context of auditory scene analysis, and more relevant to this presentation, I'd like to mention a little bit what a theory or an account that we developed a number of years, almost 18 years ago, what we call the object-based account. And this was an idea that came from the work I was doing essentially during my doctoral degree in my early time as a postdoc. And it built, or it tried to bridge with essentially the framework which was proposed by Paul Bregman on auditory scene analysis in the perspective of how we organize auditory input. this kind of framework, the idea is that you have some common sounds coming in, and that you have some sort of basic or low-level processes that will essentially group or take acoustic features and group them in some way. This will give rise to some object representation that's likely to compete for attention. If we go back to the slide I had before, you can imagine the siren competing for the attention as opposed to the people talking or the dog barking. And from there, then you can imagine top-down control processes. And we learn over the years that indeed attention can have an impact on how we're going to represent information, or it can also have an impact on how we're going to process low-level acoustic features. And long-term memory, as I mentioned a bit earlier, can also have an impact on how we process information and recover information from the auditory system, as well as perhaps having an impact on low-level representation. And all that, in fact, can be used to or is influenced by how we, what is the actual goal that we have in mind and type of task that we want to achieve. Now, the talk of today is divided into three parts. The first two parts are going to touch this aspect. And this has to do to how attention is important or can be directed to representation in auditory short-term memory. The first, we'll look at some of the early work that we did using complex auditory scene or scenario. And the second part, we'll look at whether the finding that we observed for these natural scenes can be applied to improve or facilitate speech and noise comprehension. And that, I think, will become clear as we move along. For the third, or the second one, the last part, I'm going to present some early work that we're currently doing, looking at how long-term memory can impact or steer attention to auditory object and audio space. And the part of this part essentially is to introduce to you a new paradigm that we developed. This is an area that we're pushing, but we're a little bit in the early stage in there. But as unknown, I'll show you some of those findings. So let's talk about the object-based account. The idea of this object-based account has essentially three assumptions. And like I said, the assumption one of those is that some features are integrated into some sort of perceptual object, and that there will be multiple objects that coexist in short-term memory. We had that conversation at lunch. It's quite interesting. You are in an environment, you're having a conversation at a coffee, you can stop and turn and address the conversation that occurred elsewhere or reorient your attention to another sound. That sort of behavior implies that somehow sounds that occur at the same time can be automatically segregated and maintain or represented for a certain time and remain available perhaps for selection. So that's an assumption made by this kind of account. And the other idea is that the case, then one can imagine that attention can be deployed to obviously those representations if such representation in fact do exist in short-term memory. So one of the things that we have in hearing compared to vision science is that sounds, they kind of disappear in time. And the way I think about hearing, I think of it as a very dynamic process where we have to go back and forth, because sound, what I said 5-10 seconds ago is gone. And for you to understand it, you may sometime have to go back and retrieve what I've just said in order to make sense of what might be coming. So it's really this kind of back and forth activity that I would like to argue that is very critical in auditory cognition. And one way to look at this, well, is to do what we call looking at attention to auditory memory or reflective attention. This has been introduced primarily in vision, and we've been developing or introducing it to auditory research as well. And we argue or believe that it's crucial for coherent discourse comprehension, and I hope to provide some evidence for that. The only thing is that there's not much work done in this area. And so the first start, especially when we think about how attention may help understand how do we represent these that information in short-term memory. So the type of paradigm that we use to get into it, this is work that was done, by the way, by Christina Becker, a former graduate student. We use a delay master sample. We present three sounds that have about a 1 second duration, and they are mixed together in the mixture. We've done some calibration of some pilot work to ensure that they can accurately identify these three sounds if they were in the mixture. So these sounds were chosen because they can be segregated from one another. And then we have various conditions. We can present a visual cue before telling them, okay, the sound on the left, that's the one that's going to switch position. So they know in advance what to listen for. The scene comes in, and then there's a retention interval, the probe comes out, and they have to get a response. And we use sounds that are either from music background, like oboe, piano notes, or horns, animal sound, bird chirping, dog barking, or human-made object, or human non-speech, like child crying, and things like that. In the ritual cue type of version of it, you present, during the retention, a visual that you put in this case the letter L, telling them that the left sound is going to switch position, and then you can vary the position of the retro cue to explore to what extent that information, if you give it early, does it going to help to retrieve information or maintain information? Does it going to help to choose or identify the probe later on? Here they don't have to respond. Here they have to say whether that scene is the same or different, or whether there was a switch or non switch. So this is a little bit more detail of the first project that we did on this. We had two experiments. On the first experiment, we have a 2 second retention interval. On experiment two, we have 4 second retention interval. And we have 4 position for the retro cue that we use. And here, the retro cue, what you can notice is that it's right before the onset of the probe. And that's important because it allows to look to explore whether you need some time to deploy attention or not. And in this one, you have a little bit more time than before.
Okay.
Okay, so you have a little bit more time there. So what we can expect? Well, if I come back to the general idea, if we segregate these three objects into representation, and then I can deploy attention, what I should expect is that if I give you a cue to tell you that this one's going to switch position, then you should be more accurate and you should be quicker in making that decision. If they're not separated or segregated, and you just have some sort of a gist of the auditory scene as opposed to distinct representation, then we should not see much of a benefit in terms of performance. And what we found, just to get you oriented, is here is accuracy, reaction time. This is the no cue condition, so they have no information. They don't know what to listen for. The test is quite difficult, you can imagine, about 70%. This is the pre-cue situation, and as you anticipate, well, expect, if you know in advance what to listen for, we get pretty good at identifying the probe. These are the interesting ones. And what you see is a benefit in accuracy in identifying the probe when you have a retro cue during the retention interval. So this is consistent with this idea that you have multiple representations and you can allocate attention to those object representations. In this particular case, when you get to position 4, and remember I was mentioning that this one is close, it's right before the onset of the scene, the second scene, we don't see any benefit in terms of accuracy. And what this is suggesting is that you need some time to deploy attention to those representations. When we look at reaction time, we have a U-shape, which is pretty much mimic this pattern. Very slow reaction time for the ritual cue, when there's no cue. Gain when you have a pre-cue and you have benefit there. If you increase the retention interval to 4 seconds, there's two things that happen in this experiment. The first thing that you can take from this panel is that we did observe again a benefit of the retrosuit in terms of performance. So it means that somehow we can maintain at least these representations up to 4 seconds. And interestingly, if I give a little bit more time now before the onset of the probe of the second scene, then I do get this benefit in accuracy even for the 4 second retrosuit, okay, comparatively to an OQ condition. We removed the pre-Q in this experiment.
One thing I'm not sure I follow is, why is it that the advantage of the retro cue tells you that we've already parsed the scene in advance? Why couldn't it be that in some way the whole acoustic information is held in the same way it was represented initially, and it's only parsed once I get the cue, then I attend to whatever I need to attend, parse it, and retain the information?
Yeah, if they were not the sound from the, I should have mentioned, in some, the first scene and the second scene are composed by the same event, the same sound.
Mm-hmm.
They only switch location. So it would be extremely difficult if you not separate them, if you cannot allocate to a particular subset. One possibility, it would mean that if you were doing the way you suggest, is that you would be able to allocate attention to within the mixture without the actual, yeah, I'm not sure how you would do it. It'd be very difficult to,
because if
there was no separation from the, you just have a blob of sound essentially. If there's no segregation of these events, there's no way for you to know which one's going to switch location. The only way to know that there's a switch in location between left or right is that you have these actual representation of the sound. You know, the left sound, which is the bird or the animal, switch location with the other sound.
Mm,
that's
the
end.
The blob. You said,
yeah.
You can't segregate the blob when
it's in your memory. That's how we interpret these findings.
Why isn't it theoretically possible that because when the sound is presented during presentation, you're suggesting that we can parse it, right?
Definitely
parse it. But why isn't it possible to just hold in memory the input as is, as it was initially perceived,
yeah,
and then perform the screen segregation once the cue is in your hand?
Oh, I think you could. No, maybe I did not understand your question. I mean, you could replay the scene right here.
Mm-hmm.
I think we're saying the same thing. Is you have this scene, these three sounds occur at the same time, and you have somehow you automatically separate the three of them.
No, I'm saying you don't.
You don't. So you would not distinguish between, you would not know what are the three sounds. They will be masking one another.
It will be the input.
It will be the
input. Before segregation.
And then, And you would think that even if you have no way of distinguishing, that's a mistake.
If the question is only to say whether it's match or no match, then you don't need to segregate. But if you have an explicit task for judging whether one of them switched position, then it's helpful me to see how you can do it without passing it at some point.
I'm saying if you're segregating.
There's also the no-Q condition.
Yes, there's a no-Q
condition.
Even
if there's no-Q, you still need to
yeah.
Do you know in advance when the Q will occur, or is it mixed?
Do you
know if there will be a Q or will not be?
No, it's all randomized. So they don't know in advance which. And in this case, we have other projects. This is an interesting point. I never really. You're the first one to question, yes, on this one. I mean. If it's a if there's no separation, then your performance should be quite comparable to the no cue condition. Even because you have no advantage, unless you would assume that the cue is allow you to analyze some sort of a subset of undistinguished scene.
You just parse it when the cue arrives, and
you
not when the second, and not when the second scene occurs. A bit earlier. Time in your memory.
Okay, so you would start segregation here.
When the queue arrives.
So you go, and that's the segregation, that's okay. And then when you don't have the queue, or a neutral queue, you can...
And then only when the second queue comes, that's why you don't do so poorly.
So, okay. So there's no segregation, you would argue there's not segregation here. Segregation takes place with the queue.
Could, no, not actually, I don't see any evidence for that as well, but I'm not sure why this would be precluded by the result.
Okay. That's an intriguing, I need to think this one a little bit more. Maybe because we prepared these things to be segregated to make sure that they can't, we didn't want to have masking in here, so we wanted to make sure that they can identify them. That we made the assumption that they were represented as distinct.
Mm-hmm.
But let's look at some other data and see. So this, we would argue or think that the benefit that we feel directed to is consistent with this idea that in complex environment you have this automatic segregation or separation of these events, and that these events can remain available for attention selection for at least up to 4 seconds. That's how we interpret these findings for now. So the second thing that we start wondering is, well, are these type of benefits that we see generalized to say to cases where things are not familiar? I was presenting sounds for example, dog barking, sirens, or things that are highly similar, that you can have a verbal code representation for these type of objects. So in this task, we use an audiovisual situation where we have these kind of schemata, visual, and at the same time that we have these two visual stimuli, we also have two sounds which were essentially tone complexes, chords, and they were different enough again that they could report to us that there was indeed two different sounds presented at the same time. And we do essentially the same manipulation. There's a retention interval, we give them a cue, like this one, that's to pay attention to the sound. In that sort of situation, they only have to remember the two sounds, and then the probe comes in, and the probe is binaural and either match the set from or not from the from S1. Okay, and some kind of visual and integral. And what we found is, in terms of accuracy, at least we see some benefit for auditory recognition, a little bit more accurate. We didn't see it for visual recognition, but in terms of reaction time, we found the same kind of benefit that we observed for the other type of scene that we used. So we see a gain, and that gain was comparable with it was cue to the auditory representation as opposed to the visual representation.
Curious, when you report reaction times, is this only for the correct responses?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And the cue, sorry? The cue is always visual?
The cue is always visual.
It is.
Always visual. We didn't use auditory because we were concerned about masking or causing interference with the auditory representation. So we refrained from using. So the visual cue could interfere with the visual representation, but we were more concerned about the actual object.
Do you think that's why you don't get any visual cue, or is that?
It's a good question. My gut feeling, I thought it was more about maybe the complexity of the shape somehow. I don't. It could be also an issue of sample or of power, in the sense that. That was done, if my memory is correct, with 16 participants. And you know, if we have increased our sample size to maybe 20 or 30, things may have changed a little bit. Could be a power issue. But we didn't pursue it too much. We were happy to see that this effect was not limited to these kind of type of material that you can verbalize, but it can be also observed to more abstract type representation. And that kind of project, in fact, is we have some ideas to follow up. I was chatting with some people earlier this week about how the often when we think about auditory memory, we often use material that is, at least those that look at representation with fMRI, we use things that can be verbalized in many ways. And we never really look at whether these kind of more complex abstracts can be separated or segregated. If we were to use, for example, MVPA or different technique to try to look at a different representation. And that's something we might pursue in the future. So what we have so far, well, we argue that complex auditory scenes are composed of co-occurring sound sources. They are quickly separated in sound object representation. That these objects can be available for sound down selection for at least 4 seconds. It can be longer, we don't know. Orienting attention to memory takes time. It's not instantaneous. It takes a little bit of time for you to allocate your attention. And reflective attention can act on the memory representation of both familiar and unfamiliar stimulus. So from there, we set on to look maybe at neural correlates underlying these type of processes. And the way we approach it is when you think about scene analysis, it often involves identifying what the object is. It also requires locating where the sound source is in the environment. And this often has been characterized in terms of the what and where dorsal pathways. And these type of pathways, in the case of incoming auditory input, often have been associated with a distinction of ventral for identifying auditory object, as well as more dorsal brain activation or bias toward dorsal activation when you're localizing auditory object. So we start asking questions as to whether that sort of a distinction that we see for incoming auditory event would be also present when you allocate attention to a representation using either the location of the object or whether you use its identity. What is the sound in the mixture? And whether that sort of cueing will also lead to increased performance. Okay. And that may speak a little bit to the idea of the nature of the representation and whether there is indeed this kind of type of separation. We use a slightly more complex paradigm here. Instead of 3 sounds, now we have a mixture of 4 sounds. They were presented in 3 fields. And then we give them a cue, like in this case, letter H for human sound. So we call that a semantic access. This is the cue that tells you, listen to what is the sound. You have to find out which one is the human sound, and then this is the one that's going to change, very likely to change location. And then we do a special decision where they have to tell us whether that sound is at the same position or not. So you access the based on the semantic, and you're making a special decision. We have reverse case or a different case where we use a ladder. In this case, we can train our subject, well, not train, but familiarize the subject with letter referring to the actual location, letter 1, 2, 3, and 4. And they can do that quite readily. And this is a spatial access, so they have to, when they get this cue, they're supposed to figure out what was the sound at the third position and then make a decision as to whether or not it was the same identical sound or a different sound that was presented there. Okay. And what we found in terms of accuracy, we did observe a benefit for spatial cueing, but not for semantic in terms of accuracy, but we did see a benefit, no benefit in terms of deep primes, but did see a benefit in terms of reaction time. In both cases, people were quicker in making their decision when they receive a spatial cue or semantic recuity. So behaviorally, we found pretty comparable findings to what we found before. Now, we measure EEG during the experiment, and we did 2 type of analysis. We did more standard event-related brain central analysis, time block on the onset of the retro cue, And we also did time frequency analysis, looking at brain oscillation. For the ERP data, we did what we call a spatial principal component analysis to see whether there were different type of spatial patterns underlying when your attention was allocated to the semantic, that is, what is the sound versus where the sound is located. And we carry out three different contrasts. One is to look at semantic versus non-informative, spatial versus non-informative. Those are the neutral or neutral cases. And we also did a contrast looking at semantic versus spatial resources. Now the idea is if you have some sort of a more holistic representation of the scene and you replay the scene, you may not see much of a difference between these two conditions. But if you have some sort of more specific representation or different way to access the representation, then we might expect to find some differences in terms of neural activity between the semantic and the informed and the spatial. So the first two contrasts, they show us some sort of domain general neural activity or correlate of reflective attention. Whereas the third contrast is isolating more what we would call domain specific effect, what is specific to the what and the where. So this is looking at the component. We have three components and we see differences early on. One that is more expressed on the parallel scalp region about 600 after the onset of the retro cue. This is maybe related to the time that you need again to displace or reallocate your attention or orient attention. And we do see some change, more sustained change over the central part of the brain. Could reflect the maintenance of the item. It could also be some sort of a contingent negative variation. This is negative activity related to preparation to a target coming in. It's hard to dissociate these two in this paradigm. And there was no difference in the third component. When we look at the spatial model, we found the same kind of modulation around 600 and also this kind of sustained difference in terms of neural activity as well, and no difference in the third component. And the topography was quite comparable. But when we do the contrast between the two, we do see differences at about 600 as well as some differences later in the part. So attention to one feature does not necessarily guarantee that there will be an enhanced processing of the representation of the other feature. So it seems that it can be a selective modulation. So the what and where pathway model seems to apply in this context of orienting attention to sound object representation.
This is a technical question. So you show three components because you actually look for the like the three most strongest components.
Those are the three strongest. We also did look at neural oscillation. I can perhaps go. That was time on the ratio cue onset, and we use essentially our kind of reference power here, and we look at different bands, but for this presentation we focus primarily on the beta and the alpha power. And this is a little bit of a busy slide, let me walk through it, but the take home message is relatively straightforward, is that we found greater alpha, beta, low beta, and mid beta power suppression, more suppression for semantic and spatial retro cue compared to a neutral or non-informative retro cue. And these were expressed primarily in a posterior scalp region for the alpha and low beta, but for the mid beta we get a distribution that was slightly more central. So these changes in power also are correlated with how well the participant is doing in the task. So the stronger the change, the better the performance. And that was found primarily for the two different tasks, whether it's semantic or spatial. And again, it's a little bit of the busy slide. You see it for the low beta, and you see also for the mid and high beta power. So there's some nice correlation with behavior. And
that has to do with attention, or
we don't for the attention. It's probably related to how much their ability to locate attention and be engaged in the task. At the same time, as we were doing this experiment, there was another group in Germany doing something very similar. Lim and Al, essentially, they have an S1 and S2. They use a retro cue, slightly different paradigm, but they observe also suppression following the retro cue onset. You can observe it here relative to neutral situation. And this is a bad end, this is neutral, and the topography that was slightly different or comparable to what we observed as well. The reason why I'm bringing this is I personally find I'm totally biased by having two different labs working in parallel and converging with something quite similar. And I was quite happy to see that their finding is we may differ in terms of interpretation. In their case, they argue that the change in neural activity that they observe is perhaps reflecting increased precision of auditory memory. I do not know, I'm not entirely clear whether that's the case, but the good news is that we nonetheless see comparable neural correlates that have similar pattern in terms of topography, in terms of behavior. And now the next step is to characterize perhaps in more detail, and I was quite happy to see that. So, for this, what we have so far, we have orienting attention to auditory short-term memory and then behavioral performance and modulate ERP and brain oscillation. This is found by our group as well as another group. This is consistent with the idea that we have some object feature that can be processed, represented independently in short-term memory, and that both domain general and domain specific processes underlie reflective attention. And according to Lim and Hall, then perhaps retro cueing, your ability to go back in time, may help you to either bring forward that representation or may enhance the precision of the representation, which that might explain why you do better in those trials as opposed to not. So now what I'd like to do is go to see how that sort of work that we develop in kind of more abstract domain in the case of complex scene could apply in the context of speech and noise. So let me, this, I don't think I need to go in much detail on this. Let me come here. The retro cue paradigm until recently was been used twice indirectly, in the sense that these investigators did not necessarily design the experiment, but their data kind of fit a little bit in that context. One of the first studies was by Larry Hume, who had what he called a selective condition and a divide condition. His selective attention condition was to present a cue before people were presented with a mixture of sound. They were a two talker, essentially. So that was giving a cue to attend to the male talker or the female talker. In the divide condition, he provides the cue after the presentation and tell them, now I want to know what was the story by the male talker, what was the story by the female talker. And he found some benefits in retro. This issue with this study was that there was no neutral condition, making it difficult to assess really what was the impact. It was so, and there were some differences between the selective and the divide, and there was more benefit from the selective than the divide. Golestani used something, I think, more interesting, where they emulate the paradigm which was developed by Bernstein and all, where they present a mixture of sound. This is a word in noise, which was followed by a cue, which was semantically related or unrelated. And then they have a choice selection task, and what they found is that people were much better in identifying the target when they were presented with a semantically related cue, so which suggests that somehow they can use that information to disambiguate the response. One of the things with this design, however, which makes me wonder is they could, it's unclear to what extent they go back, whether they could use a cue to try to solve this issue as a retrieval cue for the target and so on. So we think that maybe a better way to approach it is to take this part away, and instead having them to have a choice selection, ask them to generate the actual response, to tell us, what have you heard? What is the word that was ignored? And if indeed they can use that cue to kind of recover that information, then one would expect performance to be better when you have a related cue than when you don't have an unrelated cue. So this is what we did. So we have a situation like this one, where you could have the word school in noise. Yes, right here. And you can have a pre-cue, like school, the word in noise, and then they have to generate vocally the response, and we record that. And we have either a visual or auditory cue. And you have the situation where you have, in this case, the retro cue, where they have the sound and noise, you give them either a visual or auditory, and they have to generate the response. And we've done, just like we in the previous work, we also play a little bit with the time when the cue is provided, or the information is provided to participants. And what we found for the visual cue, this is, we have two different SNR, in terms of the background noise and the actual target. SNR 0 is demanding, 40% accuracy. Minus 5, it gets pretty hard. And what you can see is when there's no cue, you don't do too well. This is when you get a cue before the word, and this is not very surprising. If you have a word that is related, semantically related to the word in noise ahead of time, it helps you out to understand the word, and your accuracy jump up quite a bit. And this is true for 0 or minus 5 dB. What we found, and I think, not that I'm biased, but I think it's pretty cool, is if I present the cue after, and this is for visual, you get a benefit to the same extent as the pre-cue. Not so much, perhaps, as the minus 5, but nonetheless, you are much better than no cue. So having information after helps you out to go back to kind of recover or reevaluate that information that was presented and allow you to be better at identifying the word in noise. This is true for auditory. For visual, and also true for auditory cue as well. Same kind of benefit. And now the next question that we had is, well, how long these things? Yes. They're not different. They're not different than this. There's no
the
benefit.
The lower SNR is lower.
Oh, yeah, there's an effect, there's a main effect of SNR. Yes.
No,
no.
Oh.
No, they're comparing to the red.
Oh, this effect to
red.
That
is worse if you
it's worse.
Related.
Yes. I don't remember now. Yeah, it does look worse. This, yeah.
Trying to get the word
that is wrong.
Because it may say something about what the answer is regarding the implementation.
Yes.
Because
that's as if we have causing interference. That's a very good point. That's a very good point. Let's to we'll have a chance to revise. This is the paper has just been submitted, but I wish I wish I came earlier. That would help me. Can I come next week again? So we look also in terms of time. In this case, we only have retro queue. We didn't bother getting pre queue and so on. And what we found, there's a little bit of a change at 2 seconds, and we don't know exactly what's happening. We don't know what it's. There's 20 or 30 participants in this one. There's a fair amount of people. But the take-home message is that you do have a benefit of relatedness up to 4 seconds. So you have the word is noise, you wait 4 seconds, you give them information, and then they can retrieve or maintain that information. We don't know which direction is going yet, and this is something we're working on, but it lasts for 4 seconds and you can benefit from it. So this is quite, we're quite excited about that. So, listener can use context, and which help them in word noise identification, and this effect persists up to 4 seconds after the target. So it suggests to us that attention to memory probably play a very important role in speech and noise comprehension. So it's not just something of a fluke or something that is irrelevant. And to place that in perspective, one of the reasons we thought it was important to show that is that if this is the case, then we can work on this. As hearing loss appears, there's some aspect of hearing loss we cannot take care of in older adults. Like peripheral hearing loss, we cannot change. But strategy and skill, like attention to memory, this is something that we can train people on and make them better. And that was one of our motivation to do this kind of early work. Yes, do a little bit through other work that we are planning with older adults.
Okay.
Yes?
So, I'm more concerned about the interpretation. So, the cueing, let's say, after 4 seconds, is it a thing of memory or it biases the decision? Or can you separate the two?
I think it's hard to separate with the behavioral data alone. We are planning, we're not working on an ERP study or UG study, actually, where we're hoping to see a couple of things. Well, if I go back to maybe the paradigm. Well, just a minute here. When you get this, if it's related, there's a few things that it can be a confirmation. So if you hear a word in noise, you can generate a number of alternatives. If it's very hard to hear, you're going to, the easier it is, the less alternative. The harder, the more alternative you have to have. And you may use this as to confirm, and that will be the decision process. You will get faster because of the decision. When it's unrelated, so in this case, you have alternative. This does not match the model, and then you may go back. So with EEG, we are hoping that we might be able to dissociate the actual process where it is in the related. You might be right. We will know using EEG. Well, I don't know if we will know, but we may have some evidence that help us to decide whether the benefit is a decision process matching or whether there's really something. And my hunch is that on the unrelated, this is when we're going to see an ERP modulation, just like I showed a little bit earlier, looking at retro queue, like this change in the parallel region, like you're going back or you try to recover what was there. This doesn't match the model that I have. And to me, that would make more plausible sense. And that it would make more sense to, it's easier for the system that to generate alternatives and to confirm ahead of time than to go back. It's time consuming to go back and it take you away from what's happening right now in the conversation. what we want to do. So for the remaining time, there's not much time, and I'll go maybe quick. It's in the context of attention to memory, it's bidirectional, obviously. You pay attention to memory, you have long-term representation. Here, what I want to introduce essentially a little bit of a paradigm that we have kind of developed. People might be of interest. I don't need to introduce that in terms of gist. We create a situation where we have audio clips, and within the audio clip, we introduce a target, and we create memories. The reason we did that is we didn't want to use self-reliant memory, the people using material that is highly familiar, like personal voice or word or person name and so on. So we wanted to create something in the lab, this new pair of association between clip and lateralized targets. And this is an example of the clip. Now imagine you hear that, and on some of them, there's a little beep either on the left or on the right. And to make things harder, we do a psychophysic experiment with them, so we adjust the intensity of the beep so that's about 80% accuracy. It's close to threshold. So we really want them to listen hard to those things. And in this study or this project, we are having a learning task where we are training them to make associations between these clips and a lateralized target. So sometimes it's the basketball and the target is on the left. And we also have neutral conditions because we want to make sure that they will be exposed to sound, these clips, but there's no association. So they don't know where the target is going to be. And then we have a test phase or a memory phase where we present them with the actual clip as a cue. Then we present it again with the lateralized target. Now, if that reactivated the actual memory of the association, the idea is that in this context, they should be quicker in making their decision. They know where to expect the target.
The decision is left or right?
They have to press, when they, as soon as they hear the tone, they press the case as quickly as possible. So they know they would know in advance that, oh, the target is going to be on the right, the target is going to be on the left. And we have the neutral situation. When they have this one, they don't know. So the only thing that they can do is divide the attention between the left and the right. In that case, then you would predict or anticipate slower reaction time. This is looking at the actual learning. They learn quickly to make these associations. This is the benefit in terms of reaction time. And this is for the target absent trial, and this is the target present. So on the first, they're pretty slow, and then they, after the second, they're fast. In terms of accuracy, they jump right after the second block of trial, and you train them a little bit more, and they kind of plateau after four block of trial. So we know now that they created memory, and we can test them on their memory later about these associations right after the learning phase. And what we found is that on the valid cue, when they know in advance where the target, what does an association create, people are quicker than on the neutral when they don't know, where there was no association made. So it appears that this is long-term representation can help you guide your attention. And the better that you were in learning, the quicker, the greater the gain in response time that you observe. So this is a nice, we think a very nice paradigm that we can use now to study how long-term memory can help us deploy attention in the auditory environment in a very controlled setting. And then we can use that to study people who have mild cognitive impairment, Alzheimer's disease, or other type of deficit that we think, but in this case, would be fairly well controlled. So we've done some other studies. We look at if you have an hour retention interval, or whether you have 24-hour retention interval. In both cases, you see benefit in terms of accuracy, and you see also benefit in terms of reaction time. So these effects, these learning, travel or disassociation can be stay with you at least for 24 hours. And we observe also some EFT modulation. This is a bit hard to see on this slide. There's a difference over part of scalp region when we compare the memory cue versus the mutual, that is when there's the association. We can, there was some modulation primarily over the left parietal region. We also see differences when we contrast the left and the right cue, so this seems to know whether there's happening left or right, and this was expressed a little bit more over central scalp region. This is very, this is work in progress. I think they can work on the thickness of the line and the contrast. And we also see some changes that happen when you detect the actual target, primarily on the falling phase of the P300. So there's some modulation. So auditory long-term nonverbal material can guide auditory spatial attention and speed up processing of sound. And we have a couple neural events we think may be associated with memory guided attention, and we can use that to further understand, like I said, the neural basis of attention to memory. So, just for now, I'd like to leave with a few things. In the case of audition, sounds are ephemeral, and because of that particular nature, there may be something into the way we deal with auditory information and how attention to memory back and forth play. And that may be slightly different than what we experience in the visual system, for example. Coherent auditory perception depends on hearing back in time, retrospectively attending to sound preserving short-term memory. And this is something we continue to pursue, to explore with people who have hearing loss now and getting older, or older adults, redundantly major hearing loss. And what we found also is that attention to memory modulate activity in a domain specific area to facilitate speech and noise comprehension by bringing the past relevant event probably forward or increase memory precision. And long-term memory, like I said, so can bias auditory spatial attention and can help us filtering out the other information and do in fact better in everyday situation. And with that, I'd like to thank you for your attention.
We already asked through the talk, but are there any more questions?
Just maybe beginning when you talked about object representation in terms of mixture of signal. In those cases, they have different spatial locations. Do you think space is important, or you can attach them to different aspatial context cues and generate, again, distinct representations? How important is the space?
I think space is not so much important. I think they could do it. For us, speech was very useful in the context of having, getting a better understanding of the actual, quantifying the effect, because
yeah.
We can add them which ones which
sure.
And so on. If there are no spatial cues, in theory, I think they would be able to separate them in any case. And I didn't go in much detail, but we the way we did this was we explored the spectral temporal waveform of the different sounds, and the correlation between different pair of sound, grouping of sounds. And when you have a very low correlation, this is a situation where the sounds are very different in terms of their spectral wave shape. And that's another thing, but I think that might be one of the way we resolve these problems. Is I don't know if we have a correlation in our heads that does that, but it appears to be situation when the correlation is low, and even if it's concurrent, it's coming from the same space, we're doing quite well separating these sounds and identifying them.